Last Saturday morning, a bunch of people showed up at my house bringing with them way too much delicious food to talk about church. I divided them into three groups, gave each group a question, and I had them talk about that question and then write down some notes. And in a little while, I switched questions so that by lunchtime, everybody had had all three questions. We did the same thing again in the afternoon after way too much delicious food. One of the questions that we asked was, what does stewardship mean to you? Now, in addition to the expected responses about money and time and talents, here is what the note takers for the groups wrote down. Remember, it's not everything. This is just what they wrote that wasn't about money. Okay, it's part of our relationship with God. It is stewardship of the earth. It is taking care of our bodies. It is taking care of what God has given us. Caring for others and serving others. Today we're going to talk a little bit about those answers. And don't worry, we'll talk about the other questions over the next months. And before you ask what on earth the Ten Commandments have to do with stewardship, well, Ellen kind of said that. You can't separate stewardship from anything. But in the Gospel according to Matthew in the 22nd chapter, a lawyer asked Jesus, "Teacher, which commandment is the greatest?" And he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Now these Ten Commandments, those, tell us very precisely how to love God and our neighbor. The other 630 plus commandments are simply expansions on these 10. So that people would have absolutely no question about what is and isn't lawful. Even today, there are rabbis who continuously go through the law and add to it or make revisions to it to bring it up to date with current realities. For instance, some time back they had to decide whether putting false teeth in was work as far as the Sabbath was concerned. It is. So if you want to eat something other than soup on Saturday, you have to put your teeth in before sundown on Friday. I am not kidding. How about running a search on Google? What if it's about a religious question? Is that work? I don't know. And I'm really glad that I don't have to figure these things out, since my understanding of keeping the Sabbath holy is very, very different from the understanding that my Orthodox Jewish friend living in Jerusalem has of that same commandment. I know what he'd say. No, I can't use the internet or the telephone or anything else, and he doesn't. So if we are to understand stewardship as something that includes caring for ourselves and our neighbors, and as part of our relationship with God, clearly these Ten Commandments speak to us of stewardship, because they're all about how to love God and ourselves and our neighbors. If I love my neighbor, I will not accuse him of things he did not do, or that I'm not sure whether or not he did. If I love my neighbor, I will only want good things for her. I will not steal from her, or be angry with her because she has stuff I want. I will be happy for his successes. If I love my neighbor, I will do the very best I can that the older folks in my community are cared for as if they were my own parents. If I truly love my neighbor, I will do anything I can to keep them safe. Part of good stewardship, then, is teaching other people how to live And we do that here in church. That's what we do. We teach people how to love and how to share that love with other people, even with people they don't like, even with people they're mad at. And when we fail at teaching them that, we have failed to love them properly. We have failed to care for them properly. We have failed to follow the commandments that God has given us. It would not be possible to stand here today and talk about the commandments looking up there at number 6 without talking about what happened last Sunday. We cannot look at the words, "You shall not murder," and not think about Stephen Paddock going into his hotel room in Las Vegas with 23 firearms and a whole lot of ammunition, and deliberately firing hundreds of rounds into a crowd of people enjoying a concert. We cannot look at the words, "You shall not murder," without thinking of the 58 people who were killed and the hundreds, 500 some, who were wounded. I cannot think of his actions without wondering how he went on. Somewhere, somehow, the message that murder is wrong didn't get through, or at least it stopped connecting for Mr. Paddock last Sunday. It's a week later, and investigators still have no idea why he did this thing. He has no history of mental illness, no domestic violence in his background, none of the normal signs of a disturbed mind or internalized rage. Nobody seems to know or understand what was going through his mind or what triggered his actions. Somehow he got the message in his mind that it's okay to kill people. Even though God's commandment clearly states, "You shall not murder." Even though the laws of the land say the same thing, even though he had to know from watching television, if nothing else, that his actions were certain to result in his own death, whether by his own hand or at the hands of a police officer who would then forever have to live with the knowledge that she or he took a life. Somehow, despite all of that, he got the message that it was okay to take not one, but dozens of lives. And I think, no matter what his motives may have been, whatever they eventually figure out, that ultimately it's our failure. We, the church, failed to reach him. We failed to teach him. We failed to love him. And we failed at teaching him to love. And he isn't the only one we have failed. There seems to be a growing belief that if somebody disagrees with you, it's okay to hit them. Now, I've heard there's a poll that has a percentage of how many that is. I can't find that poll, so I can't quote it. It is somehow a growing belief that if you don't agree with somebody, it's okay to hit them or call them names or destroy their property or something mean, not loving. Monday evening, I attended a city council meeting. There were a number of very unhappy citizens there, worried about the crime rate in our city, worried about gangs coming into our city, worried about violence, which has taken some lives. I heard those people say, "What are you doing? Why aren't you fixing it? We need more police to prevent crime." And I heard another pastor say, "Hey, the churches, we're out there working with the people. Come join us. Help us. Help us make the change." And the people continued to complain and to point fingers, and I stood up and said, "When the churches are out there working to heal our neighborhoods, where are you? What are you doing to make a difference?" Now, I know that some of those folks go to churches. And I'm sure that some of them participate in programs to, you know, help out people at their various churches. And they support charitable causes. I'm pretty sure I know that to be a fact, because I recognize some of the folks. And all that is very good, and it's a start. But the thing that has to be done is to root out the anger and the hatred and the bitterness within every heart, including our own. Because in case you can't tell, I'm a little annoyed. The thing that has to be done is to change our society. So it's no longer okay to hit somebody you don't agree with, or call him names, or damage her property. The church is supposed to teach love for the neighbor, and we are responsible for our sisters and our brothers. We are our brother's keeper. It is our job as Christians to change the world, the whole world. For Jesus was sent to save the whole world, all of it. To reconcile all of the world with God and with each other. And Jesus left us behind instructions on how to do that. It's our job to love our neighbors, all of our neighbors, even the angry ones, even the gangbangers, even the people who stand up in city council meetings and argue, or say, I'm locked and loaded, let them try to come to my house. Or, I guess I need to take matters into my own hands then. It's our job to teach them that that's not the right way to do this. Part of good stewardship is taking care of our community and the people in it. Not just feeding them and housing them and giving them resources that they can be helped through, but helping them to reconcile whatever it is they're upset with, whatever it is that makes them angry, whatever it is that hurts them, giving hope where there is no hope, helping people understand that they're not alone in this. There are people here ready, willing, able to listen, at least. Helping them know that somebody cares about them. Our theme this month, as Alan pointed out, is journey to generosity. That journey is not toward a generosity of finances and other gifts to the church, but also toward generosity of your spirit. It is a journey toward forgiveness. It is a journey toward willingness to reach out to people that we may not agree with or even like very much, to assist them in healing, to assist them in learning how to love the neighbor, to bring them hope, to help them heal. Stewardship is about being in relationship with God and with each other. When we go from this place today, everyone we meet, let us spread joy and hope through the love of our neighbors, so that wherever we have been, peace follows. My brothers and sisters, if you want to rededicate yourself to Christ, or if you would want to become part of his family through baptism, or if you want